Good morning and welcome to the Little Home Church by the Wayside. Everyone here and everyone who will be watching the service this week on YouTube has a place here at our table. Today, we will be looking at the struggles of Job and the rich young ruler, as well as gathering our neighbors in need offering for the United Church of Christ. We want to welcome today a member and a special guest, Maureen O'Donnell. Maureen lives in Maine now, but she's back, and she'll be here next week, I think, too, celebrating our 150th anniversary. And we're delighted to have her. She was at the meditation service, the contemplative service on Thursday night as well. So welcome back. She stays very much in touch on YouTube with us, and it's one of the wonderful blessings of that. Please fill out a visitor's card that's in the pew and drop it in the offering baskets when they come by later. And if you're watching online and you want to receive more information about the church, be registered as a visitor, please send us an email. SIS is collecting 150 pairs of socks for the 150th anniversary. Those will all go to homeless shelters. We're continuing to collect the magazines for the Illinois Youth Center. And October 16th and 17th, next Saturday and Sunday, the weekend we've all been waiting for, the 150th anniversary of the Little Home Church. According to county records, it was October 8th was the actual day. And so that was a great thing I learned this week from Art and Gail Swemke. And so we will be celebrating next weekend. On the 16th from 5 to 7 with a wine and cheese reception sponsored by the men of the Little Home Church. Sunday morning, our services will be later. 10 o'clock coffee hour outside on the patio, sponsored by SIS. 11 o'clock service in the sanctuary with a world premiere. We have a piece commissioned by Joel Rainey for brass and choir. We'll have quite a big musical presentation for that day. And afterwards, from 12 to 2, an after party with Jorge Brito's band, Salsa del Norte, as well as food trucks, bouncy house for the kids, face painting, ice cream by Kimmers. So it's something you won't want to miss. And this is very, very important. Very important. Everybody has received a postcard, a magnet for your refrigerator. You have gotten an email. You'll probably get an email reminder this week. You can be the marketer for this. All you have to do is push forward onto your email list and send that out so that we have a full house and a wonderful time for 150th. Following that, at the end of the week, Mary Emily has our first, and Diane Dipner, our first launch of our small group dinners on October 23rd. And then finally, and this goes again with what we're talking about today with Neighbors in Need. Finally today, we are doing hygiene kits through our outreach committee. These are disaster relief kits. We chose to do the hygiene kits, and all of the needed elements in the hygiene kit are in your bulletin, and we'd encourage you to either make a cash donation, or, and we'll do the purchasing of it, or you can go ahead and put together kits. Several have come into the church. It's great to see people taking time to do that. That goes to people who have suffered from floods, hurricanes, fires, that sort of thing around the world. Anybody else have an announcement this morning for us? Oh, Lori. She's reminding me. No, she's like, no, Larry. Where would I be? So, for the 150th, we have a commemorative ornament, Christmas ornament for your tree. This is a lovely picture of the church in the front. Beautiful colors, and on the back, the 150th logo. They're $15 each, and they will be available starting next week. I believe there's just a limited number of them, 100, so you will want to be sure to get in on that, because once they're gone, they're gone. All right? So that's our 150th commemorative ornament. Anything else? Carol.
I'll make this real quick.
It is.
I'll make this real quick. One thing Larry forgot about next weekend, after the service, we're going to ring the bell 150 times, and Chuck and Julie are going to be our helpers with that. So get your muscles ready, because if you want to ring the bell, we're going to count it 150 times right after the service. So that should be a lot of fun.
All right. Anything else? Announcements are very much an important part of the life of the church and part of our worship. We celebrate that and all that's going on in our congregation. So with that in mind, let's continue our worship.
Good morning, and please stand if you are able for the call to worship. The Word of God is alive and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing until it divides soul from spirit, joints from marrow. It can judge our thoughts and intentions of our hearts. We cannot hide, for we are naked and laid bare to the one whom we must render an account. Let us hold fast to our confession before Jesus, who was tested as you and I, and yet was without sin. We approach the throne of grace with boldness, so that we may receive mercy and find grace to help in our time of need.
For our first hymn this morning, we are going to do hymn number 5, and it's a tune that comes from Japan. It's known as Sakura, or cherry blossoms. And so I thought it would be really nice, and I don't see that we have any of our kids here today. It's going to have them ring some of the high bells, so I'm going to pass these out. It's just a random ringing of the bells. It's just like a little wind chime that's going on during the Japanese tune. So give me just a second to pass out the bells, and then we will we'll do the hymn. I'll do a brief introduction of the hymn, and then when we start singing the hymn, you just randomly ring the bell like it was a bell peal. All right, there's no on the beat, there's no anything. It's just a lovely effect.
Thank you.
Please join me in our prayer of invocation. O God, you sowed the seeds of justice when you created this world. Though your bountiful creation has enough for everyone, it is hardly divided fairly. There are those who struggle to get their daily bread each day. And then there are those who have more than they can use in their lifetime. May we remember that all we have comes from you, and that you have entrusted to us all that we have. May we take your commandments to heart so that we can do as Jesus asks of us. Grant that we, O God, use this hour to work in our ministries to end this disparity. Amen. Please join in our prayer of confession. Almighty and Holy One, we cannot begin to count all our possessions. We have things in our closets, our attics, and our basements. We have things tucked away in boxes we haven't opened in years, and still we acquire more. We have so much stuff, and yet there are those in our communities who can fit all their worldly possessions in a shopping cart. We know that you, O God, will defend the poor and come to them in their need. But we, O God, need your forgiveness, for we are more attached to our things than we willingly acknowledge. Help us comfort our attachment to possessions and things more honestly, so we can share our own abundance more equitably. Amen. We draw false and fleeting comfort from our material things. True comfort comes from God's love for us, and by responding with that same love to family, friend, neighbor, and stranger. By God's love, we are forgiven. Let us do likewise. Amen.
Thank you.
before we do the passing of the peace, I'd like to point out that in the back over here, we have He Would Win the Distance banners, we used to say in Sunday school. We have a gentleman who's visiting family in Batavia. His name is Leon, and he's here from Belgium. Leon, we welcome you to our service. And also my friends, Ted and Lynn Hardison, are here today, and welcome to you as well. So please stand. May the peace of Christ be with you. Greet each other with a sign of peace. All right, let's have a seat here. It's a holiday weekend here for the schools, and so we don't have any kids here. I think everybody took a little weekend away. So what we'll do is change the order here a little bit. We'll do joys and concerns, the pastoral prayer. I'll finish with the Lord's Prayer. And then Samantha will do our 150th moment here. I'll just say briefly, so Ron and Maggie, you're off the hook. You can stay in church here today. So we had a coloring page. I'll be sure that the kids get this for next time. But it's called In a Just World. So in your bulletin today is, we'll be taking along with our regular offering, there's an envelope for our neighbors in need. And a big focus of neighbors in need this time is homelessness. And there are a lot of interesting facts about that and important for us as a local church and a larger church to support that. So I'd encourage you today to maybe do a little extra two separate offerings here as we do our neighbors in need. So let's go into a time of joys and concerns. Does anybody have anything they'd like to share? Jane?
I will project out. My concern is for our sister in the choir, Susie, who has a breakthrough case of COVID, and she's been really sick. So please pray for Susie. I know that she prays for all of us all the time, and she really needs our love and care. Also, her son Josh, who lives with them, also has a breakthrough case. So, prayers for the ailing Lindquist family.
Anyone else? Yes, Mary Jean. Okay, and I'll repeat that. So prayers for Dan Roach. Dan had some back surgery this week and longer hospital stay than thought, but he's home now. Yes. Anybody in the Schles group want to do a little joy?
Well, George.
Yes. Yes, as a matter of fact. So, yes, George Bouchard passed the bar exam. That was it. That was what I was looking for. You done good. You done good. You got it. All right. So, yes. So, George Bouchard passed his bar exam, which is an excellent thing. I joked with him a little bit this week, said, I was passing a bar. Does that count? And apparently it doesn't. It's not the same. Tim. So he is also already hired through the DuPage Public Defenders, and he's a good man to be representing all of the people who need him there. That's awesome. Anyone else? In the back, yes, Denise. Oh, that's awesome. And it's his senior year, right? What a great thing to go out with. That's awesome. Anybody else? We have one more. Oh, in the choir.
I don't say it every week, but just prayers for my mom. Happy Abel. She's this past week. She had good days and she had some bad days, but she's still with us. So that's good.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Anybody else? Okay. Please, let's enter into a time of prayer. God, thank you for the abundance of life, relationships, health, comfort, and wealth you have provided. And thank you that even in times of need, despair, and brokenness, you were there. Please put your arms around children and families in extreme poverty so they feel comfort and hope, meet their needs both physically and spiritually. And Lord, guide us so we can be your hands and feet pursuing justice for the poor and upholding the cause of the needy. Lord Jesus, carpenter and king, supreme sovereign of all humankind, look with tender mercy upon the multitudes of our day who bear the indignities of justice everywhere. Raise up leaders in every land dedicated to your standards of order, equity, and justice. Grant to us, Lord Jesus, the grace to be worthy members of your mystical body, laboring unceasingly to fulfill our vocation in your church. Sharpen our intellects to pierce the pettiness of prejudice, to perceive the beauty of true human brotherhood. Guide our minds to a meaningful understanding of the problems of the poor, of the oppressed, of the unemployed, of all in need of assistance anywhere. Guide our hearts against the subtle lure of earthly things and undue regard for those who possess them. May we hunger and thirst for justice always. Lord, this morning, we specifically uphold Susie and her family, her son Josh, as they heal from a breakthrough of COVID-19. We want to uphold Dan, who's going through recovery from surgery. We also uphold Kathy, who has her struggles with her cancer. Be with her and her family as they all help her in what she needs. And we celebrate with George for starting a new career and for being in a public defender's office who will be helping those who are in need of justice and mercy and compassion. We celebrate with Jake and his home run. We celebrate our community, and we can be so grateful that we can all feel joy and compassion in our hearts for this young man and for that moment in his life. Lord, bring us together as we pray the prayer that you taught us to pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. We're going to invite Samantha Prang up, and she's going to do our 150th moment this morning for us.
Good morning. My family moved out to the suburbs from Chicago when I was 3 and a half. My mom grew up in a UCC church, and she wanted that for my sister and I, and eventually for my younger brother. She tested out Little Home Church by enrolling us in Vacation Bible School that summer, and as the saying goes, we never looked back. When you're little, you don't have much choice where you go to church, but LHC was comfortable and nurturing with Pastor Bill, Pastor Patty, and of course, Pastor Ron. I participated in Sunday school, Vacation Bible School, youth retreats, a pilgrimage, the youth group, and of course, many, many, many Christmas pageants. Mrs. Shelton was my confirmation mentor. Little Home Church was my church family. My family has always supported me with my different interests and decisions, and believe me, there were many. Just ask my mom how many times I've seen the musical Wicked. My Little Home Church family was no different. When I chose to enlist in the Army after high school, my LHC family supported my decision. Whenever I came home on leave, I always made it a point to go to church during my time here. I wanted to see my church family. When I spent a year in Afghanistan, I felt this church's love from 7,000 miles away, with cards and letters and welcoming arms when I returned home. Kay Brynelson sent me scripture readings and always asked my mom, "How's our girl?" Mrs. Bouchard, Mrs. Shelton, Mrs. Kaska, and Larry came to my swearing in when I was hired in Geneva as a full-time firefighter. And FYI, I will always call them Mrs. Bouchard, Mrs. Shelton, and Mrs. Kaska. When my grandma died, the women of LHC hosted a wonderful memorial lunch in the parish hall. It was a pretty fun party. Just like with any family, you help out when you're needed. I've been happy to help out with the Christmas pageant over the last few years, and now I'm happy to continue to bring our worship services to the people who cannot join us online. It's my way of giving back to the family that has given so much to me. This church truly is a family, my family and your family. I've seen through my 29 years how this church, this sweet little church, is there whenever you need them, because that's what family does. Thank you.
I'm a little shorter than Samantha. Our first scripture reading today is Job chapter 23, verses 1 to 9. Then Job answered, "Today also my complaint is bitter. His hand is heavy despite my groaning. Oh, that I knew where I might find him, that I might come even to his dwelling. I would lay my case before him and fill my mouth with arguments. I would learn what he would answer me and understand what he would say to me. Would he contend with me in the greatness of his power? No, but he would give heed to me. There an upright person could reason with him, and I should be acquitted forever by my judge. If I go forward, he is not there, or backward, I cannot perceive him. On the left, he hides, and I cannot behold him. I turn to the right, but I cannot see him. God has made my heart faint. The Almighty has terrified me. If only I could vanish in darkness, and thick darkness would cover my face." Our second reading is from the Gospel of Mark in the New Testament, chapter 10, verses 17 to 31. As he was setting out on a journey, a man ran up and knelt before him and asked him, "Good teacher, what must I do to inherit eternal life?" Jesus said to him, "Why do you call me good? No one is good but God alone. You know the commandments: you shall not murder, You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not bear false witness. You shall not defraud. Honor your father and mother. He said to him, Teacher, I have kept all these since my youth. Jesus, looking at him, loved him and said, You lack one thing. Go, sell what you own and give the money to the poor, and you will have treasure in heaven. Then come, follow me. When he heard this, he was shocked, and he went away grieving, for he had many possessions. Then Jesus looked around and said to his disciples, How hard it will be for those who have wealth to enter the kingdom of God. And the disciples were perplexed at these words. But Jesus said to them again, Children, how hard it is to enter the kingdom of God. It is easier for a camel to go through the eye of a needle than for someone who is rich to enter the kingdom of God. They were greatly astounded and said to one another, Then who can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, For mortals, it is impossible, but not for God. For God, all things are possible. Peter began to say to him, Look, we have left everything and followed you. Jesus said, Truly, I tell you, there is no one who has left house or brothers or sisters or mother or father or children or fields for my sake and for the sake of the good news who will not receive 100-fold now in this age, houses, brothers and sisters, mothers and children and fields with persecutions and in the age to come eternal life. But many who are first will be last, and the last will be first.
For the word in Scripture, for the word among us, for the word within us. In our text, Job makes his case to God loud and clear. Today also, my complaint is bitter. Job literally wants to make a case before God. He wants to set up a trial. Job earlier has spoken of the bitterness of his soul. Therefore, I will not restrain my mouth. I will speak in the anguish of my spirit. I will complain in the bitterness of my soul. I loathe my life. I will give free utterance to my complaint. Have you ever said or heard the words in your house, I wish I was never born? Same idea. Here, Job is correlating his own bitter defiance with what he's going through, with the unrelenting pressure of God's hand upon his life. Job insists on seeking a resolution for his complaint, not through the traditional religious practices of prayer and lament, as we find so often in the Psalms, but through a legal hearing, because he feels that he has a case against God. But Job is confronted with a dilemma. He does not know how to find his way into God's presence. God seems absent to Job. We identify with Job's complaint and the laments of the other Old Testament writers because they express our own feelings. There are times we do feel let down, alone, and abandoned. In today's society, it is clear that a church or a Christian who goes on singing happy songs in the face of glaring disorientation is very different from what the Bible itself portrays, particularly in Job. The reason for the lack of lament is seen in our text, stems from the thought that the acknowledgement of such negativity is somehow an act of unfaith, which really suggests that God has lost control. The admittance of something not going well or as planned might be seen by some as having a lack of faith or failure, whereas the biblical laments are to be seen as acts of bold faith. So for a minute, think of those times when you've planned something and they just haven't gone as planned, and you do feel alone and left out. It is part of life. One of the things I love about our service is when we enter into a time of prayer, we allow for joys, but we also allow for concerns, for lament. Lament is part of worship. It's a big part of the Psalms. Majority of the Psalms lament besides praise. I think in our own church and our community, we're going to celebrate the 150th next week, and we have a lot to celebrate. We have a little lamenting going on. We've been stuck across the courtyard, but we're getting there. We had a great meeting this week, great meeting with the Joyful, Joyful campaign, and we're able to move forward in spite of obstacles, but life has obstacles. And it's there, and we can express those, and God is with us in those things. Old Testament scholar Walter Brueggemann points out that a lament or complaint is an act of bold faith on one hand, because it insists that the world must be experienced as it really is, and not in some pretend way. On the other hand, it is bold because it insists that all such experiences of disorder are a proper subject for discourse with God. There's nothing out of bounds, nothing inappropriate. Everything properly belongs to this conversation of the heart. To withhold parts of life from that conversation is, in fact, to withhold part of life from the sovereignty of God. The frank language of Job, taking God to task and seeking to have a trial before God so that he can lay his feelings bare, is something that the church and Christians have intuitively avoided. The deep feelings of his heart are expressed to God, who is the final reference for all of life. For both Job and ourselves, honest confession is a catharsis cleansing the heart, and such honest confession produces transformation. Every biblical writer who, in the midst of doubt and despair, makes his feelings known to God, breaks forth into a new discovery of faith. Job had his troubles, he expressed it, and through those 42 chapters, he makes it to the other side. We talk sometimes about childhood faith. Here's a wonderful story about someone who knew how to find God. Robert Coles, a child psychiatrist who taught at Harvard University, decided to travel to the South in the early days of the civil rights struggle to see for himself what effect the tension was having upon little children. He soon developed a special interest in Ruby Bridges, a six-year-old black girl. She walked bravely to class each morning, accompanied by federal marshals who protected her from the ever-present abuse of an angry mob. How was she able to stand such tension? Where did a little girl like Ruby get such courage? One day, Ruby's mother felt comfortable enough to ask Mr. Coles, Professor Coles, to come to the house. She talked to him at the kitchen table and inquired about what kind of questions he was asking her daughter. He explained that it is important to learn how she was handling stress. He queried her about her appetite, her sleeping habits, and other relevant matters. Ruby's mother replied, "You're a doctor, and I shouldn't be asking you questions. But my husband and I were talking the other night, and we decided that you asked our daughter about everything except God." That was a turning point for Coles. When he saw Ruby again, he quizzed her from a different angle. Where did she get her courage to face those angry mobs every day? She replied, I am sure the Lord was watching, not only me, but too. Coles went and visited her Black Baptist church and learned what gave her courage. The gospel, the supportive fellowship of a loving congregation, as well as her own family, enabled that remarkable young girl to go to school every single day. Here's another story, and I just couldn't pass this one up. We're going to go into the gospel lesson now. The rich young ruler. A man who was an expert in diamonds happened to be seated on an airplane beside a woman with a huge diamond under him. He introduced himself and said, I couldn't help but notice your beautiful diamond. I am an expert in precious stones. Please tell me about this stone. With a twinkle in her eye, she replied, that is the famous Kloppman diamond, one of the largest in the world. But there is a strange. Now the man was really interested. He asked, what is the curse? As he waited with bated breath, she replied, it's Mr. Kloppman. So diamonds and riches, the choir sang about that this morning. I'd rather have treasure in heaven than riches on earth. So back to the rich young ruler. This is a story much more about eternal life than just money. This is a story about grace. This is what God does for us. It's what Jesus was trying to get across to our man in the gospel lesson today. We don't have to try to do everything imaginable in order to attain God's forgiveness, mercy, or love. All we need to do is open our hearts to God, expose our failings and our mistakes. It's not about the deeds. It's about the relationship. Much like we should practice with each other. Jesus is the master of the teachable moment. He teaches by challenging people with their own assumptions. And here's an example from that story. When the young man approaches him and says, good teacher, what must I do to obtain eternal life? Jesus immediately realizes the framework from which he is coming from. It's all in that one word. Obtain. This was a young man from privilege. Some versions say inherit, also something we might think of with someone from privilege. Jesus replies, no one is good except for God. Right there, we see Jesus trying to make a point that the gift of eternal life is not about our goodness, but about God's goodness. It's not about what we do, but about the gift we receive. He doesn't get it. And he still starts talking about maintaining that he has kept all of the laws his whole life. The next part is really important that Maureen read. And this is from the scripture. Jesus looked at him carefully and loved him. Then he said, you are lacking one thing. Go sell what you own and give the money to the poor. Then you will have treasure in heaven. Me. There are a lot of conversations about this passage. I remember it being terrifying when I was young and growing up. It's not a sell all that you have. Jesus identified in the young man that although he was following all of the rules, there was a disconnect, that connect that he, as a rich young ruler, was connected to the poor homeless person on the street, and he needed to do something about that. Is the parable about money? No. The parable is about the difference between obtaining and receiving. As the gospel story goes on, Jesus sits down with his disciples after this event. After seeing the list impossibly long and high of things they would need to do to be perfect, they are shocked, saying, "Then Jesus, who can be saved?" Jesus' answer, "It's impossible with human beings, but not with God. All things are possible for God." What do we need to do in order to be in right relationship with God and each other? Be honest. We must expose our humanness to God, to each other, the good, the bad, and the ugly. This is the gift that God gives to all of us. We are who we are, and that is good enough for God. All things are possible with God. The poet and writer Ted Loader wrote this piece about honesty in relationship. "How shall I pray? Are tears prayers, Lord? Are screams prayers, or groans, or sighs, or curses? Can trembling hands be lifted to you, or clenched fists, or the cold sweat that trickles down my back, or the cramps that knot my stomach? Will you accept my prayers, Lord, my real prayers, rooted in the muck and the mud and the rock of my life, and not just my pretty cut flower, gracefully arranged bouquet of words? Will you accept me, Lord, as I really am, a messed up mixture of glory and grime? Lord, help me. Help me to trust that you do accept me as I am, that I may be done with self-condemnation and self-pity and accept myself. Help me to accept you as you are, Lord, mysterious, hidden, strange, unknowable, and yet to trust that your madness is wiser than my timid, self-seeking sanities, and that nothing you've ever done has really been impossible, so I may dare to be a little mad too." It's good to ask questions. It's a good and right thing to do. It's good to allow God to receive you as you are, and it's good to tell your story in honesty to other people. There was an incident at that we had a while back, and I happened to walk in and just meeting some guests and shaking hands. And being honest, I had come in from the city from the night before. And when I introduced myself as the pastor of the church, someone said, "You sure don't dress like the pastor," when I was going to church. And I said, "Well, lots of things have changed. And the church has changed, and we're growing, and we're being more honest, and we're being real." And so often, in order for us to take that message out there, we need to tell those real stories of who we are, just as we are. For God is always with us. His eye is always watching us in love and care. Ask the questions. It's a good and right thing to do. Amen.
This is the time in our worship service where we actively and intentionally take part in the support of the ministry of Christ. If you are a member of Little Home Church, we encourage you to continue your pledges and financial support. And if you are visiting with us today, we welcome your gifts as well. For those of you who may be watching this on YouTube, the information is on the screen at the close of the service. You may donate through Venmo, PayPal, or by sending a check to the church office through the mail. We should not forget that our offering should be the first fruits of our labors, which we dedicate to God. Not only do we honor God by this offering, but it also helps us not to keep the best of what we have.
for ourselves. By giving our first fruits to God, we help to ensure that those who have little will receive something, and we who have much do not keep it entirely for ourselves. Please join me in the offertory prayer. Generous God, we thank you for all that we have and for all that it comes from you. Gratefully return a portion of what we have to you. May our offerings sustain and support the work of this church. Between those who have much and those who have little in this community. Amen.
Thank you. getting seated. Go forth this week like Job and the rich young ruler in their struggles for answers to the tough questions. Know that God is there with you at all times, and may the God in you, the divine image to which you are made, see the God in me and all of the wonderful saints who will cross our paths in the days that lie ahead. Amen.